My name is Corey Graves, and I am a junior film and television student from Lake Forest, California. Thanks to SCAD and the wonderful connections I have made in the entertainment industry, I have had a privilege of working on a number of professional sets in Georgia, including Ozark, The Act, and Council of Dads, which is actually screening here tonight at 7:30 p.m. Yeah. While pursuing my dream of being a professional director, I directed last year's SCAD sitcom Grits. Yes. And I'm gearing up to direct this year's new sitcom Split Ends. And all of these opportunities have been absolutely incredible and completely unexpected, but very few compared to the honor that I have today, which is presenting this year's Discovery Award to Hunter Schafer. Hunter is not only one of the stars of HBO's latest groundbreaking series, Euphoria, she is also a personal hero, a champion for the marginalized, and a symbol of fortitude for her years spent fighting for LGBTQ+ rights. In Euphoria, we are launched into a visceral reality of American teens facing life-defining struggles. The series addresses issues that are far too often muted and ignored just in general. And as much as Euphoria is a necessary vehicle for these kinds of conversations, it's also an amazing opportunity for brave young artists like Hunter Schafer. The series is Hunter's acting debut, but you would never have guessed it based on her emotional range and honesty, her technical command, and her presence on camera. She has the courage to mine her lived experiences and bring believability to her character. As Hunter said about her experience filming, I'd have to remember a new detail, dig up an artifact from within myself, and hold on to that moment for the scene. She knows what it means to step into a public forum and open yourself to whatever comes. She does this with zeal, she does this with compassion, and Hunter compares acting to writing a letter to someone, combining experiences that have a common thread. Based on her inspiring work in Euphoria, she has many more letters yet to come. Let's take a look.
When was the last time you didn't wear a hoodie and sweatpants?
I don't know, like now?
Exactly. Which is why we're gonna finish. You would die for Anna.
Who's Anna? She's just like
next level.
And you guys like hook up or something?
It was kind of crazy. We went to the club and the energy was like crazy in there. It like matched hers. And then I was feeling it there. Mm-hmm. You look beautiful.
SCAD welcomes this year's Discovery Award honoree, Hunter Schafer.
So much for being here. This is pretty wild. I don't know if I've done something quite like this before yet. I don't know, I heard there's a lot of students here, which is really sweet. Yeah. I was about to go to fashion school right before, are there fashion students here? Yay! I got like kind of swooped up into the Euphoria gig. I want to like encourage everyone to sort of explore all the pathways that even like you might not think you're ever capable of, or I don't know, like I thought I was destined to be like fashion and visual arts forever, and now I've been like acting for 2 years or like something like that, and it's like influenced my entire being as an artist, and I feel like I'm still a student too, so thank you so much. Wait.
Let's hear it again for Hunter. Amazing. You sit over there. I'll give you that mic.
Thank you.
All right. Well, the first thing I want to say about Hunter is that she is also one of the nicest people, as well as the most creative people working today. One of the things that's fascinating about your little journey into this role is that it was entirely unplanned. You did not grow up thinking you were going to be an actor. You were creative, but in many different ways. So talk just a little bit about, because I think a lot of people here would like to know that the path isn't always linear. So how did it happen?
Yeah. How did it happen? I grew up like drawing a lot, painting a lot, and like wanted to be a comic book artist for a little while, and then realized I really just liked doing the costumes of the comic book characters, and so then that got me into fashion design, I was really shy too. I never saw myself like performing or like screaming in front of 200 extras for a scene or like that. That was not in my vision for myself at all. I got into modeling because I wanted to be in close vicinity to the fashion industry, and that was kind of my way in at the moment and my way out of North Carolina, which is where I grew up, and I was like, hell yeah, so I'm gonna take that. I guess that got me a little bit more comfortable with performing. I was still trying to keep up my, like, I was still trying to go to fashion school right after, like, a year of modeling, and then this happened, and I guess, like, if I've learned anything, it's that, the thing that's made me make shit, like, my whole life, I always do this because it feels like a little, like, vibration that's, like, you gotta get out.
It comes from your heart.
Yeah, yeah. That, it just ended up being a learning experience of, like, not putting that through my hand and, like, through, like, your face and your body and, like, a lived experience, which was really freaky and mind-blowing, like, as a new actor. But, I've realized that it's, like, all the same vibration, which is kind of what I was trying to say up there. Like, yeah.
You're being modest, but she was really talented as a designer, and you were set to go to London to study fashion.
Mm.
Not cheap, so you had to make money to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And then you were in New York modeling at a very high level and living in a model apartment, which sounds glamorous, but it isn't, okay? That's like a nightmare story. Anyway, so yep. You were in a model apartment, and then your agent actually, you got hooked into the idea of doing Euphoria, just kind of spontaneous, sort of came as an opportunity you weren't looking for.
Yeah, the casting folks for Euphoria, Jen Venditti or JV8 Inc., at least that's who I came in contact with first, they do these, they do a lot of, like, street casting, so they'll literally just, like, walk up to people on the street, but they also reach out over social media and like, circulate casting calls and whatnot.
You found out through Instagram.
Yeah, like, that's where I first saw it, that people were, like, reposting and, like, telling each other to audition for this thing, and I was like, that's cool, like,
why not?
Nothing more than that. And then the request came in from my agency.
And then you went and actually had to do scenes, right?
Yeah.
Part of the audition process for Euphoria was pretty intense.
Yeah.
So let's talk a little bit about that.
Because
that is not a traditional audition. Your first set of auditions are auditions that, like, veteran actors would be like, I don't know if I want to do that.
No, it was definitely a little intimidating, just as far as the three scenes that they picked out for the audition. It was like, they were all pretty intense.
Which is funny because Euphoria is an all-American, happy, you know,
yes,
wholesome. I was like, what?
A sweet family drama.
How did this is seventh heaven? What happened? I don't understand. No, it's nothing like that. Okay, so talk about that process. So you actually did scenes, and some of your scene partners actually ended up in the series with you, in fact, I think, right? Didn't you?
Yeah. I mean, Barbie and I were both models in New York before all this. And so we weren't necessarily, like, auditioning in the same, like, we weren't doing scenes with each other, but we were going in at the same time. And so that we got to know each other pretty well through that process. And then for my final audition, which was, like, really, it actually kind of looked like with the lights and, like, being in front of, like, an auditorium of people you can't really see. It was, like, it was kind of like this.
This is all an audition for the next scene. And you got the part. Anyway, go on.
But Jacob and I did like my final audition scene in the space like this, which was cool. And then met everybody else when we were filming the pilot.
Actors, I think there's a misperception of actors that you know you are very confident to put yourself in these positions, but in fact, you're a vulnerable person, and you had to find a way to kind of act through things that were really intense. And I'm wondering, it was sort of mentioned in your intro, you found pieces of experience, but this is a totally different person with a much edgier life. And I'm wondering how you approached those scenes.
I mean, the character was... a lot of the kind of more intense stuff was infused into the character from Sam Levinson, the showrunner, creator, writer, director, like he does everything. He infused a lot of his experiences into that, and so I felt like it was my job to sort of find what felt parallel or comparable or like useful for moments like those, even if it was like a smaller like sized occurrence, like back like in my memories just like more finding a feeling and then like holding on to it, which is like a lot. I knew it was gonna be hard, but yeah, it was hard. It's a weird thing to like do to yourself.
Everyone in your life, everyone in the country was shocked, I think, by Euphoria, surprised, horrified, riveted. Did you pave the way for people in your life and say, well, you're going to see me in an entirely different way, get ready, or maybe let's skip that episode? Or
I definitely had to warn my family about a few episodes.
We should say your dad's a pastor.
Yes. Yes.
So that was an interesting conversation.
Before they ever ended up like seeing the show, I did bring each of them out just to like show them what I was doing, because I think there was like also like a like, hi, I'm acting now. I'm moving to LA. Like this is I don't think they, like, I wanted to bring them out to, like, show them what we were actually doing and, like, show them that we were kind of legit. And I think, like, they could tell that I was really, I was, like, happy, like, filming, or just really engaged and just, like, so excited to be, so immersed in such, like, a massive creative project. And so like I think that was more important to them than anything else, we skip a few scenes. It's not that hard.
Fast forward exists.
It's a good tool.
Sam and you have a special relationship. Sam Levinson, the showrunner, has based a lot of what is in Euphoria on high school experience and in Los Angeles, and you know, in a maybe a little different than our hometown of Raleigh. But I'm wondering what that collaboration is like. Mm. Obviously, you bring experiences and he brings experiences. And one of the great things about Sam is that he honors all the actors' kind of narratives and what they see. So talk about, you know, when you get scripts or when you're rehearsing scenes, how that goes.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's really, it feels welcoming as far as, it feels more like a collaboration than like someone's giving me something to like work with or become, which is like, it's a special feeling. And like, of course I would be honored to like take something on from him that like I do need to like put myself aside for, but he's just really open, and so open in the fact that like he would sometimes, he's like, okay, no more script, like we're done with that, like this is gonna be like y'all are starting here and just go off for 5 minutes, because it's so much about like actually like having it come from like somewhere that we're both feeling. And I don't know, he's also infamous for like coming up to one of us while we're filming and like giving you like this insanely like beautiful pep talk, like in like whispering in your ear, and like, and then he'll be like, go. And
I need a person like that. So he just comes, right? And what does he say?
Just like trying to remind you of something. He also like knows a lot of all of our like tea, like as far as what gets us going. So he might remind us of something, or describe or articulate a feeling, and
that's a good segue for something else.
Sorry.
Yeah, let's talk about Jules and who she is. She's a character with an enormous heart and some questionable choices. I want to talk about how you think about her. And as I said, I think maybe all actors with a big signature role get associated with the character, but she's an independent, you know, being. Talk about how you see her and where you think she's going. I mean, she's on a train, for those of you who don't know. Spoiler alert. Come on, it's already happened. Catch up. I want you to sort of talk about her experiences and what informed your performance. And I don't mean just in terms of your own life. I think in terms of the lives of other people who may be in her shoes, and why she does the things she does.
Yeah. Like why she, like,
her relationship, certainly her approach to sex is not.
Yeah.
It's dangerous.
Yeah. I think in a sense it's her relationship to sex can be comparable to Rue's relationship to drugs, or like Maddie's relationship to Nate, or like Kat's relationship to doming people. Everyone's like searching for a feeling, or a euphoria. It's not necessarily harmful. It's like trauma shit. I think it's like, for Jules at least, what's driving her to do that, or like making her move like that, goes way back. Like way, way back. And because for like where I go for that sort of stuff are like feelings that I've wrestled with like mostly my entire life, you know? It like stuff you can't explain, I think.
The thing about Jules is she has power in some of those situations. Mm-hmm. And you can see, those of you who have seen the entire show, and you know that her origin story, such as it is really terrible. Like, there's a harrowing sequence with a young actor who plays you as a young person and what happens to Jules, and it sort of informs and explains why she puts herself a little bit in these positions where growing up among, seeing how women are treated, you get the sense that she gets power from these dangerous encounters.
Exactly.
You know?
Exactly. And I think what she's looking for is sort of like the most intense, like it's weird to think about like how she sort of uses misogyny to affirm herself.
Right.
And like what she puts herself through is one of, like, at least like dynamically such an intense form of like misogyny. It's connected to that and needing to experience misogyny in order to feel affirmed. It's a spiral and a half.
And welcome to America.
Yeah.
It's fascinating, right? Because there are dynamics where most of the men that she's drawn to obviously are wrestling with an internalized, deeply internalized homophobia, and they're working their shit out in dangerous ways.
Yeah, and not even necessarily like homophobia, because like Jules is a girl,
right?
And but I think it's that they both end up in situations where like she can't like go out and like fuck one of her classmates,
right,
the same way she could maybe with
a married man with a teenage son.
Yeah, in a motel room that no one knows about. Yeah.
Now, I want to be clear about what I'm saying there is that there's these needs of to declare why they're, I mean, which has nothing
right
to do with Jules. It has to do with,
yeah,
their complexity.
It's like ending up in the same weird, isolated state from very different places.
So we should talk about the scene with Nate and the intensity of the scene and how you got to it. This is a relationship that's really not good. And at the end of the scene reaches a kind of crescendo. Sorry, I have a retainer in. And that's a hard word when you have a retainer in. Anyway, in that moment, you cut yourself. But what's most fascinating about the moment is what happens after that, where you kind of move your body like, okay, here I am. This is me. But it's almost like you're coming off a high and you're stumbling out of it. And I wanted you to talk through how you rehearsed that and how you came up with how you did that. I mean, it's a very physical scene in a fascinating way, but it's so raw. And there's almost, I don't know if you studied when people are really angry and then what happens to their bodies once they've sort of really gone too far.
Yeah.
But that's totally readable in your, it's a magnificent piece of acting, actually.
Thank you. Yeah, so that scene in particular in the kitchen is something that Sam pulled from his life when he was around Jules' age, or maybe around Jules' age. So one, I had a great resource who'd been through it firsthand, like pretty much that exact situation. And two, wait, what am I?
How did you get there?
To
it is one thing to live through a trauma, and
yeah,
it's another thing to say, okay, let's do trauma really big.
Yeah.
You know?
I had worked on, that was one of the audition scenes, so I'd been working on that for months at that point, and with, like, the director of that episode and with Sam, and we had really narrowed down, like, what memories I had of like gross, scary experiences with like dudes that I don't like, you know, kind of finding those, and that's like a whole process of excavating, because I don't want to think about that, or like, and I don't think about that on like a daily basis, or like want to remember it necessarily, but I did have like a grasp of those at that point when we got to filming it. I was also just so so I was really emotional that night. Because I was like one of the new actors on set, and I knew that was a big scene for me, and I was so like really scared of not being able to like deliver and like actually like match or like be able to engage with Jacob the way like we should as scene partners, and I was just like so scared of everything. I broke down and just sort of, I feel like after you break, it's like everything just kind of pours out, which is what it felt like, I guess.
Well, go check it out if you haven't. If you're an actor, watch it many, many, many times. Especially for Jacob's, the fear in Jacob's eyes is also pretty great.
Yeah.
You scared the shit out of him.
He was scary too. Yeah. Well, in that like character.
Yep.
And in it, he's tall and like
he's a big guy.
It was like, yeah, sprayed down with oil and stuff. It's like it was intimidating.
It was a lot.
Yeah.
It was a hell of a lot. Yeah. Well, another relationship. I think actually the pivotal relationship of the entire show is what you go through with Rue, it's probably the most complicated and heartfelt depiction of an adolescent friendship, with all of its layers, and it goes through every layer by the time you get to the train station, and obviously your partner in that is a very experienced actor. Yeah. And this is your first rodeo. Yeah. So that must have been a bit like, how am I going to get through this? This is Z.
Yeah. Yeah. I was definitely nervous about that too, particularly in the pilot. I think it was also like she had never done a role like this before.
For sure.
And so I think we both approached it with a fear, like different fears coming from different places. But I think it was cool because we were able to like bond over that in a way of like being like, this is like kind of nuts.
Do you remember when you found out that she was going to be, you were going to be doing, I don't know, well, a good chunk of work with her, and it was going to be her that you were going to be taking this journey with?
Yeah, I mean, well, we were getting scripts all the way through the season. Like we didn't get 8 until right before we did 8. So I didn't, like, exactly know how long their relationship was going for. I don't remember like when I found out, but I remember like hearing her name in the mix, and I was like, whoa, that would be like that's different. Like,
and of course then you immediately in this performance got huge positive affirmation critically. What was that like? I don't know if you read that stuff or you ignore that stuff.
I try not to, but it's also, I think the affirmation is nice as well. I'm excited to do it again because I want to try again. Like, because I feel like I want to push myself harder.
Well, you're coming back for another season of this.
Yes. Yes.
And we know you know more than you can say, probably. But we're going to spend the next half an hour talking about everything that happens in season 2. Go. No. It's fine. You can just tell me. When you started this journey, though, with the show, you had no idea. I mean, it was 8 episodes, and then to find out you're coming back. as much as you can say, I mean, again, I think most of you know that there's a finale in which the two friends are headed on a journey, and then really Rue decides she can't go with you. And she's in a dangerous place because she's an addict, and she's clearly relapsed. Mm. And you still make the decision to go, which was interesting, given the intensity of the relationship. So just talk about filming that. You really get to a very emotional place, and it's just the two of you, and you're running through Union Station to get to the platform. Talk about that.
Yeah. Yeah, that scene was, that was a long night. I was really mad at Jules for that.
Selfish Jules.
But at the same time, I just think, like, no, don't leave your friend slash, like, lover slash whatever, like, alone in a train station at 1 a.m. Like, are you stupid? No.
Your high friend.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know. But at the same time, she's 17, and she's also been through some crazy shit in this town.
And she needs to get out.
And she needs to get out. And that's also, like that feeling, like I know where all that was coming from too. And I think she felt like really, like, stuck. And Nate had been manipulating her and, like, forcing her to literally do crime. And then Rue was sort of suffocating her with, like, replacing her addiction with Jules. And I think it was, like, all too much. So it's justified. Like, it in one sense, it's justified. And in another sense, like...
You know what I liked about that scene is, I think, although I don't know many people who have taken their lives to that extreme, I think there is something about teenage friendships and needing to save yourself, even though it means sacrificing that other person, that is sort of universal, that there's an intensity of the friendship that exists that's self-destructive and a little scary. And what Jules is essentially doing there is saying, I can't save you, so I'm saving myself.
Yeah, and she can't save Rue, and she shouldn't be Rue's savior. Like, that's not, yeah, she, that's
and
not
Rue is replacing
position.
An addiction, really. She's hooked into Jules in a way.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, it was like, yeah, it was like fentanyl or Jules. Like, that
hard
was
choice.
Yeah.
Don't take the fentanyl.
Which isn't a fair place for either of them to be in, but addiction is a beast.
Can you say anything about the next season in terms of how you, I'm trying to think of things that won't put you in a bad spot, but where you see things going for Jules? Well, let's do it this way. What would you like for Jules? What would you like to see her do?
I would like to see her, I would like to see her, like, sort of, I think she should be, like, allowed to be more angry, or feel like she can at least, like, not have to run away on a train at 1 a.m. in order to be okay. Like, and if that means, like, being more explosive or more putting up a fight back at home, then I think, like, that could be fulfilling for her as far as, like, finishing high school.
Be a good goal.
Yeah. Yeah. And then I want her to keep exploring.
And what does that mean for you in terms of exploring? So this is going to go for a little while. You never knew you were going to be an actor. You're really good, so that's nice. And people are calling you, And are you thinking about what kinds of art you want to make beyond the context of the show? And what are those things?
Yeah. It's the show. I definitely subsumed in the show when we're filming, and I'm about to again. But I definitely am never letting go of my visual arts practices. Those have been like a way for me to make sense of things for way too long to like put that down. So that'll be a thing. I need to get a new sewing machine so I can start sewing again. And yeah, I'm trying some new practices too, but I don't know. I'm trying to keep some of it, or maybe a lot of it, for myself too, because one practice is so, now it feels like it's so for like a lot of people. I think it's good to have a balance.
Would you, based on your relationship with Sam and thinking about, would you think about creating stuff in the space of television and movies in terms of directing or writing or?
Yeah, he's really encouraging of that too. I think for like all of us. But there are definitely worlds that I don't see right now, like in media, that I really want to see. And like, there's a lot that hasn't been on screens yet or like portrayed in that sense that I'd be really interested, if not making myself, then like using what I have to elevate from people who could probably tell the story much better than I could. So just to participate, would be magical. It's something I am planning on doing.
So we have about 4 minutes left, and I always like to ask people about the art that inspires them. What made you who you are? What films or movies or clothes kind of got you into the space where you wanted to be talking to all these nice people here?
Let's
start with a book.
Inspired me.
Inspired
growing
you.
Up.
Yeah. Growing up.
Let's see. A book. I was really into graphic novels and comic books when I was younger. So like Teen Titans. So good. That TV show as well. I haven't really watched the new Teen Titans, but the old. Okay, noted.
Some strong feelings about the Teen Titans.
Yeah. What else? Let's see. Paris is Burning deeply affected me. That's a great movie. Everyone should watch that if you haven't seen it already. I was just talking about this with my publicist last night. What else?
Those are pretty. I should have given you
Teen
some.
Teen Titans and Paris is Burning.
That's pretty great.
Like, you know.
And Teen Titans, were there particular characters that you Raven or
Raven?
Yeah.
How did you know? Yes.
Because I read the Teen Titans. It's not like, you know, I fell off a turnip truck.
Yeah, yeah. No, Raven was just like the first one.
Raven
you said
had Raven. A lot of issues. She was really unhappy, and wasn't she like basically the devil's daughter at different times? Maybe
not. Oh, yeah, she was. Yeah.
She was.
Yeah.
She had that cool hood. Now I'm really geeking out. Anyway,
wow.
Go read that, especially the Perez, the original series. It's amazing. The art.
The book?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Gotta,
ooh.
Gotta go look at
I
that.
I don't know. Okay.
Anyway, it is a pleasure to get to talk to you. I want to say just one thing about what Hunter's been able to do, which is so rare in this work. which is to find the authentic truth of a character and make her relatable to people who may have nothing in common with her in terms of her specific experience, but can find little touch points of humanity. And that's what the whole game is in acting. And to have that happen in your first job is just sick and wrong, but also really cool. So it's been a great pleasure, and you are very deserving of this and many other awards. So thanks, Hunter.
Thank you very much.